Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Welcome, everybody, to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm Kendra Cook, and I'm here tonight, as always, with Dan Olsen.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, we people.
Look, our tables are close together again.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. I hope that means COVID is going bye-bye.
Right.
I hope so. So, welcome, everyone. And like I said, this show is brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. If you would like to learn more about the museum, you can visit our website, www.boyertownmuseum.org. If you'd like to visit us, our address is 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. Give us a call, 610-367-2090. Come visit us. We are open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. We're closed major holidays, and I think the next one coming up would be Labor Day, Monday. So, look, all the rest of July
now,
and August.
You say we're closed Labor Day, but that's sort of like a rest day for the museum staff and a lot of the volunteers. Because why?
Well, we're closed.
How's that for a segue?
Thank you. I appreciate it. We are closed actual Labor Day, but just 2 days before that, on Saturday, September 4th, is our Duryea Day antique and classic car, truck, and motorcycle show and flea market. This will be the 55th this year. Should have been 56th, but we had to cancel last year. Sorry, but we're back here in 2021, and we're excited. We are starting to get some people to register. If you have a show vehicle that you would like to register, contact us at the museum. We'll make sure you get a form. And it's a really neat day. We have gotten up to 700 cars and trucks to show. So we're looking forward to it. We're hoping for good weather. Crossing our fingers. You and I were both at the McCungee truck show.
Right.
Which was Father's Day weekend. And they had, I think, 900 and...
I think 40.
Yeah,
maybe?
Something 30, like that. 40? I was going to say 30. Yeah,
and you figure a lot of those vehicles are a lot bigger than the vehicles that show up at Duryea Day.
Trucks. And not all like pickup trucks. Like big rigs.
Big.
Fire engines, and so they had a good weekend, so we're hoping that's gonna bode well for us. So that's Saturday, September 4th. Mark your calendars. Of course, if you don't have a show vehicle or you just can't bring one this time, it's a great show just to come walk around and be a spectator. So there's lots to see. And we have another event coming up before then. It's coming up pretty soon. It's going to be Sunday, July 18th. This is something new. We've never done this before. It's called a current event, and it is an EV show or electric vehicle show. We're going to have modern-day electrics, but we're also going to have some older electrics, including one of our friends that we met up with at the truck show, actually, a 1933 Thorn gas electric hybrid. Really, it's cool.
Is that what year that is? 33?
Yes, a 33. Okay. Yep. So that's coming. It's really neat. We're having some modern day electric race cars, courtesy of Entropy Racing. And come to see their electric race cars, but also come to see, I think it's a 51 LaFrance fire engine that they converted to a car hauler. So that's not electric, but That is also quite a fascinating vehicle. So they'll be there. Like I said, we'll have some other modern day things. We'll take out some of our electric cars as well. So we're looking forward to it. So that's Sunday, July 18th, and that's 10 to 2. It's in our parking lot. The electric vehicle show in the parking lot is free. You don't have to pay anything to enjoy that. If you want to go to the museum, you do pay admission, but the actual electric vehicle show is free. So we're looking forward to that too. All good stuff, all exciting stuff. It's nice to get back into the swing of things. We're trying to do some cool stuff and get people excited to be out and about again. So,
and I've noticed that we are opening up more, and mm-hmm. it's not just, you know, every place you go is, you know, you can walk into a store without wearing a mask,
yep.
and, you know, the whole thing.
Yes.
But we've been opening up because mm-hmm. now, just in the last week, I've done some tours at the museum.
Yeah.
So it's kind of neat to have groups of people coming
the tours
in.
Tours back.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know,
kids.
You had billions of them.
It felt like billions this past week. There were a lot of kids bunch. Tour yeah. groups in.
So it's yeah, and we're yeah. getting stuff, and it feels cool. back to normal. And I've been, this is a little off here because I know we're not doing it yet, but I've been telling the visitors, and especially the kids, I says, you tell your parents to get online and check out the museum's website, mm-hmm. and probably next April we'll be having a diner day. And I says, I want to see all you kids here with your parents,
yes.
and buy me a slice of pie. So
you are not going to be able to get out of that booth if all those kids buy you a slice of pie.
I don't think any of them will buy me a slice of pie. But it is, you know, that's always a fun event.
And, it is.
You know, and I shouldn't have even said it because we don't have anything on schedule yet, but...
Not officially, you know, but we're talking about it, so we're trying to figure out how to do it, and it's going to be hard to get back into doing some of this stuff.
I just don't think so, not with pies.
Hopefully it's like riding a bike, you know.
Yeah,
you
pies are easy.
On. Yeah.
yeah.
Everyone likes pie.
Everybody,
coffee.
Yep.
Just
yep.
make them happy with pie mm-hmm. and coffee. So, yeah, we're getting our events back on track, and, stay tuned to our website, and if you're... on Facebook, stay on our the museum's Facebook page. Actually, this show, Wheels Along the Road, has a Facebook page too. But stay on the museum's Facebook page, and the most up-to-date information gets put out there almost daily.
Hmm.
Put something on there. So that's cool too. Yeah. Jeez.
Okay.
Phew. I'm tired just thinking about it. Which means I'm going to hand it over to you now. So
great, thanks.
Dan has been hovering between a couple topics here. So
hovering.
I know.
Okay.
You know, Dick Van Dyke makes a really good hovering noise.
Really?
That okay. episode.
Sorry. I must have missed that one.
It's the one about the walnuts.
Sorry.
I'll send you a link.
Okay. Do that.
Okay.
Okay.
Right.
So,
yes, like I said, you've been hovering. So what did?
Okay.
What have you gone with?
What I was doing. This was a little while ago, and I was thinking, you know, what am I going to do for the show, and this or that, and I was looking. I was reading a magazine online, and the mm-hmm. magazine was Motor Age, the June 29th, 1905. I'm a little behind in my reading. Okay. Actually, and I looked at a page, and you're going to see that in a moment here, but I was doing this last Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
And I looked. Last Tuesday was June 29th.
Yeah.
And in the magazine was June 29th. I said, wow.
Did a double take.
So it was a 116-year difference, wow. Okay? So, okay.
116. So, and that was a car periodical.
Yes.
It's just a... That was a periodical for this already, mm-hmm. 116 years mm-hmm. ago. Anyway.
So if you can show the first picture there. Yeah, that's it. That's a page out of the magazine, page 78 if you're taking notes. But you can see four separate advertisements there, and we're going to be talking about three of them. And, you know, the thing is, I'm going to say that it's more exciting maybe to hear about newer stuff, but... This old stuff, I think both Kendra and I enjoy
it's
it.
So cool.
And you can kind of connect it to things today, or maybe things in our museum, which is older stuff too. But, you know, it's important to know where the history of the automobile started from and the connections and, you know, all that stuff. You know,
you can see what they were trying to do.
Yeah, and they're trying to do all sorts of things.
Yes,
and all three of the ones I'm going to talk about is kind of odd stuff. Okay, so we're going to be talking first about the one on the lower right-hand side, and that's the next picture there. There you go. An icy leather tread or leather tire tread. And I could find very little about that. It was made by the Irison Leather and Export Company out of Boston, which is right there on that. And it talks about these treads are made from anhydrous leather. I never even seen that word before.
What is anhydrous?
Well, I had to look it up.
Yeah, I would have too.
Contains no water. So it's free from water and especially water of crystallization. So I guess it's just really dried out leather.
Wow.
I don't know what advantage. Maybe it made it tougher or something.
Huh.
You look at that picture, which isn't the greatest picture, and it seemed like the tread went on top of the tread of the tire. But it shows no way to connect it. It doesn't mention about it. Anyway, the text there says it's made of anhydrous leather, the only leather on the market which resists water and oil, the only leather suitable for facing clutches, brakes, and for mud guards and repair sleeves for tires. That's a lot of stuff. But again, I could find very little about that. Yeah, so who knows? An IC, I'm not sure what IC means, you know. So, I mean, the name of the company is Irison Leather and Export, which would be ILEC. I don't know.
I see it.
But as we were saying before I introduced this, you know, they were trying all different things. So, you know, the rubber and tires back then wasn't the greatest. The tread design, you know, they just had smooth tread there.
Mm-hmm.
Before the non-skid was coming. So they were trying all different things. And you can see, you can see some lines going across there, and I figure that would give you a little bit of traction too. But as you can see, there's no connecting to the tire that it's on or the wheel or the hub or anything. So
at first glance, I thought those lines were like straps, but you can see those are like grooves.
So who knows? And I found, as I said, I found like nothing. You know, I have a paragraph from a magazine introducing this, and it doesn't really say much. Instead of being made in a single continuous band extending all around a tire, like most separate treads, it is made of a number of sections applied separately. There are no steel rivets in the leather. It is claimed that the leather tread is attached in such manner it will not come loose. But it doesn't, who knows, yeah. Prevents slipping and skidding, prevents tearing and puncturing a tire, keeps the tire cool, can apply to be old as well as new tires. So, I don't know. Okay, so that's the IC leather tire tread. And let's go on to the next advertisement. And this is a car called the Gasalec. Is that how you would pronounce it? Gasalec?
I guess.
Okay. And that, as you can see on there, it talks about the simple car. You see that written in there. And somewhere else in there, it says, marks a new era in automobile construction. So there it is, 1905, a new era.
We've barely had any era.
You ever hear of this car? No.
I've never heard of it.
Made by the Corwin Manufacturing Company of Peabody, Massachusetts, successors to the Vaughan Machine Company. In 1905, it started as the Vaughan Machine Company, which was known for processing machinery for leatherworking, textile, and printing industries. Leatherworking. Maybe they made the IC leather tire treads.
It's all connected.
I don't know.
It's all
anyway,
interconnected.
So that the name of that car, the Gasalec, stood. The gas part was for gasoline, of course. The AU, the AW, stood for auxiliary, and the LAC means electric. Okay, so it's gasoline, auxiliary, electric.
I thought it was trying to sound like
I don't know.
French or yeah. European.
Well, that's what I thought when I first saw it. But the thing is, I got all excited. I said, whoa, a hybrid gas electric car for back then. But then I started investigating, not really, So this car, the one you're looking at there, had a 40 to 45 horsepower, four-cylinder, four-cycle engine. So they said they claimed to combine the advantages of gas, steam, and electric, which I'm not really sure what advantages they were talking about. There was an electric motor connected to the drive shaft used for starting, reverse, slow speeds through traffic, and added hill climbing power. So it was an auxiliary motor. It wasn't a gas electric hybrid, but it was, It said every movement of the motor power and the car from a state of absolute rest forward at any speed or reverse is controlled by one lever, operator either by hand or foot as preferred. So who knows what was going on here. Again, very little information here. It had electromagnetically operated valves with driver-operated variable timing, which I think that was probably what we see today in cars. There was no starting crank, no camshaft, cams, tappets, and it says without changing gears, which I'm thinking there was no transmission in it. Again, very little thing. So in 1905, it started as the Vaughan Machine Company that made it. 1906 got reorganized as the Corwin Manufacturing Company. 1907, they were out of business. They reportedly only four cars were sold. So, so much for being a new era in automobile construction.
It was a very short era, wasn't it?
And it said, not an experiment, but a success. Not a freak, but a practical revolution. I don't know how much of a success it was. Okay.
Corwin, why does that sound familiar?
I don't know. It sounded familiar to me, too. But I don't know. It must be something else.
I thought that was local. No. Corbin.
With that B.
Yes. I'm thinking of Corbin. Okay.
Yeah.
Darn.
So, I'm looking at this, and I said it's not a hybrid, but what is the real definition of a hybrid? I mean, it used gasoline motor on here as well as an electric motor. Excuse me, gasoline engine as well as an electric motor. But that electric motor was only used here and there. But I think in a hybrid, it's sort of the same way, too. But anyway.
Now, it says it has the advantages of steam as well. What?
That's right. Who knows? What kind of advantages?
How does it incorporate any steam?
Yeah. Well, it's just the advantage of it. I'm thinking steam was pretty powerful.
It was,
and maybe
yes.
That's what they're hinting at.
It could be.
I don't know. Again.
If any of you have a gas luck in your garage, let us know. Yeah. We're going to find out the steam connection here.
Okay. The third thing here, which is the next advertisement, is the Q&C Stanwood Automobile Step.
Ooh.
And you look at the picture, if our technician could see. Okay.
Beautiful.
I was thinking, you see in the rear entrance, there's a step there that is above the running board.
Yeah.
And that is what they're talking about.
Oh.
Sort of. I started looking up all this stuff. I looked up.
So they're not talking about the long.
Let me go here. Okay, I looked up Railroad Appliances Company out of Chicago, Illinois, which shows on this advertisement, and I came up with stuff. This advertisement also says the very best step for automobiles, as it never wears out, requires no repairing, and always looks well. The steps are made of crimped steel, act as foot scrapers, keep the car clean, and allow dust and mud to fall through. That's what this advertisement says. All right. I looked up railway appliances, and they're making appliances for railway.
Okay.
And this whole idea as a step is for getting into trains.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
Where you might, you need the same thing, you want the dirt to fall through. I looked up Stanwood, you know, and you probably do the same thing. You're searching for this, so you go on Google and you type this this word and you look, and well, maybe it's this word or that two words or this combination. You keep going through, and I'm doing all this.
It's true.
Stanwood, from what I understand, is not like a trade name. It is not the brand name. It's a type of step. Stanwood, because I found other companies that made Stanwood.
Didn't know there were types of steps.
Yeah, and I came with one. This was 1915. Okay, this advertisement's 1905.
Okay.
And I came, this was the Automatic Appliance Company out of Boston. And they made a Stanwood safety step plate. It says, has brought out a running board attachment to prevent the tracking of mud, dirt, snow, or water into the car and ensure a foothold when stepping in or off the running board. The device consists of a series of high-grade, semi-pliable rubber segments inserted in an embossed metal plate enameled rubber gray. It is firmly secured to the running board by head screws, which are furnished with each plate. With each plate, they're listed at $3.50 each. So I saw that, and I believe that was the one. There was a catalog online, and you could read every page. It was like 20 pages, and I'm going through. And it had all these different things for trains, mostly trains.
Yeah.
Except this, and it was basically a metal plate with inserted strips of rubber into it. But there was grooves in it, so if you wiped your feet, the thing would step.
Yeah.
Okay? So I believe this was, that Stanwood step is just a type of step for railroad cars, street cars, automobiles, whatever. And I wrote here, tread made up of thin strips of high carbon steel, bent so when they are assembled, they form a series of openings in the surface of the tread. Now, you see in my notes, it says the dragon
now
running board.
Now I know why you wanted the dragon
photo. So we have, in the museum, we have a dragon, which is 1907, has a running board, similar to the running board on that car in the picture. And it's most running boards are just solid, and they have linoleum on it.
Yes.
You know? I would say, out of all the cars we have, majority
of them
have the linoleum. The dragon, though, it looks like grating. And it's, the edge is not
sharp.
Yeah, it's kind of serrated.
Yeah.
So on most cars, it's comfortable to sit on the running board. On the dragon, after a while, like
it's
3 seconds.
It's like acupuncture.
Yeah, it's very rough. And so there it is. It's the Stanwood. And it's just one of those little things. You look
it's
at our vehicles
enough. I always thought the dragon's running board was weird.
Yeah.
Because nothing else in the museum is like that.
Yeah. But it's interesting, you come across these little things, and I was studying this and everything, and again, I was looking at just a little step on this car, and then it dawned on me, hey, the dragon.
The dragon,
and I wanted to take pictures of our fine viewers today, but I kind of forgot.
It's, don't step on it in your bare feet.
Yeah.
It's like pointy.
But you do need that running board to get in a car because that first step up over the sill of the door is like, you know, 3 feet maybe.
Huh.
It's about that. Two and a half, 3 feet.
It's high off the ground. Like, it looks like this one, similar.
Yeah. Yep.
Even in the body style. I mean, there's a door in the back, but ours doesn't have, but the same kind of look to it.
Do you know, this is totally different than what I have here, but you know, this car just had doors in the back, and when they started putting them in the front, they were advertised as four doors, not F-O-U-R, but F-O-R-E, because door, get
back
it? The front,
four.
Yeah. And so most, when they started, they were just like in a picture with no door in the front.
But why is it called a Q&C?
I don't know. The same reason that the leather tire tread is called IC.
So
I don't know.
Who can we write to about this? It says write for Circular. Do you think they'd respond?
I don't know. You can write for Circular. Well, the IC Leather Tire Tread says samples and prices on application. So there's your job,
I?
Yeah.
All right.
Your job, not mine. Okay. Two last things here. There's another advertisement on here, but you have to tune in next month to find out about it.
Ooh.
Because that advertisement opened up all sorts of like really cool stuff that I want to share. And it's all, not all, but a lot of it's Pennsylvania stuff. And I usually try to bring Pennsylvania stuff to the show here. But I think this is like the third month in a row I have not. But
well, I'm abandoning Pennsylvania too tonight, so don't feel bad.
Yeah, well, I will feel bad. Okay, so
we'll
that,
make up for it.
That
next month.
And the last thing, and you'll like this. Okay, today is Burt Ward's birthday.
Aw, is
and
it?
Who's Burt Ward? Tell
Did
our fine
Did you send
viewers.
Him a card?
Yeah. No, I didn't. Who, people want to know who's Burt
it's
Ward?
Robin.
Yeah. Yep. It's his birthday today.
Best sidekick ever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I knew you would know that. So, okay. Anyway, that's what I have today.
I love
or
it.
Or tonight, this month.
I love it.
So tune in next
yes.
month.
Yes. You definitely should, because I am sure that I have not done as much research on your topic next month as you have.
What, but the Treebird Gas Engine Company out of Rochester, New York?
Well, the thing that's connected to it.
Yeah, the stuff in the bottom of that advertisement.
I think it's interesting, so you probably have a lot more information than I do.
Cool stuff.
It is very cool stuff.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm gonna real quick here tell you a little story about this character up here. It's not a
meet me.
Oh, well, Dan's also a character, but I won't tell you a story about him today. This I almost said gentleman, but sort of. Anyway, this is Carl McGee. And this is not a great photo because the really good photo I have of him will give away everything. But I believe this is from his obituary. And he passed away in the 1940s. I think it was 46 he passed away. But anyway, he was born in 1872. And he was a journalist and reporter at the New Mexico Star Tribune when in the 1920s, he was one of the journalists that broke the Teapot Dome scandal, which is kind of confusing, but essentially the Teapot Dome scandal was a bribery scandal involving President Warren Harding. About 1921 to 1923 is when this was kind of blowing up in his face. And basically his Secretary of the Interior leased some petroleum reserves out west to a private company without taking any competitive bids. And actually his Secretary of the Interior was the first presidential cabinet member to go to prison. There's something to be proud of, I guess.
And what year was that?
This would have been the early 20s that this was going on. So
100 years ago.
And really, before Watergate, this was probably considered like the biggest political scandal in the United States was Teapot Dome. And Warren Harding was very troubled. He had a couple of other scandals that were going on beforehand. And Teapot Dome kind of broke the camel's back, so to speak. So this is one of the gentlemen who broke that story. He also, a little later in 1925, he got into an altercation with a judge that he criticized for being corrupt. And the judge was kind of ticked off at him and punched him in the face. And McGee pulled out a pistol and shot at him and unintentionally killed a bystander. So this is from the, this was in Las Vegas. This is from the newspaper there. So the bystander's name was John Lasseter. He was killed at, it was called the Meadows Hotel in Las Vegas. Will charges be filed against Carl McGee, editor of the New Mexico Star Tribune, who shot Lassiter unintentionally during a fight between the editor and former judge D.J. Leahy? McGee was attacked by the former judge, his political enemy, and knocked to the floor twice, according to witnesses. The shooting took place in the Meadows Hotel. According to an eyewitness's account, McGee was sitting on a lounge in conversation with da-da-da-da-da when Lassiter and Judge Leahy entered. And Leahy, you know, punched him with his fist on the side of his head. Second blow knocked McGee to the floor. As the editor arose, Leahy attacked McGee, witnesses said, kicking and cursing him. Lassiter stepped forward to pull Leahy away just as McGee pulled his gun and fired. Mrs. Patterson, who had watched the fray, ran forward and caught Lassiter as he fell. He died just as a physician arrived a few minutes later. Judge Leahy, it is understood, was wounded in the arm. As he left the hotel, he remarked to a companion, "I think my arm is broken. I better get out of here." TV Truder, assistant district attorney, said that a charge of manslaughter would be filed against McGee if the coroner's jury returned a verdict against him. McGee's 18-year-old daughter witnessed the fight and fainted. She is under a physician's care. "My heart is broken, but my conscience is clear," McGee said after the shooting. "I am too distracted over the unfortunate circumstance of Lassiter getting in the way at that moment to feel like attempting a statement. A half dozen reputable and responsible people saw the entire incident, and I'm willing to allow the outcome of public opinion and abide by their statement of the occurrence." McGee is suffering from 3 broken ribs and severe body bruises. Leahy is under arrest at his home here. McGee, through the Tribune, a Scripps Howard newspaper, has waged a determined battle against alleged corrupt practices in New Mexico politics. He was sentenced to jail by Leahy for contempt of court following publication of editorials, blah, blah, blah. This is like some Wild West stuff in 1920s Las Vegas. But guess what? McGee was acquitted of manslaughter, and he moved to Oklahoma City to run the Oklahoma News in that town. And this is all very colorful, and he did something that we think of as very mundane in his time in Oklahoma City. By the 1920s, when he's here, traffic is a problem in cities.
Okay. It just struck me.
Just
okay.
Struck you.
Yeah.
Traffic's a problem in cities. One of many issues, people that work, you know, they're there for 10, 12 hours a day. They're parking and just leaving their cars sit on the street all day. Well, this is annoying the shop owners because now the spots out front of their shops are being occupied all day. People are getting frustrated and they don't stop in their shop because they can't park and they keep going. And, you know, people are having a tough time finding parking spaces. So they just kind of park in the flow of traffic and are mucking it up that way. I read something, too, that certain store owners would go park their own cars in front of a competing store's storefront just to be a jerk and then deprive them of a customer, really. So this is going to be a problem. So Carl McGee here, and there he is at his desk in Oklahoma City, he is still with the Oklahoma News, the paper. And he sets up a contest in the paper that asks for University of Oklahoma students, engineering students, to design a timing device. And the purpose is to allocate basically a set amount of time for parking a car. And this is actually kind of tricky because they have to think of, there's a couple things that this machine has to be able to do. It has to be able to operate no matter the weather. Obviously, it's going to be outside 24/7. It has to be something that's difficult to vandalize. And it has to be relatively inexpensive because you're going to need a whole lot of these to monitor parking in an entire city. So the winner, oddly enough, is this parking meter, and it's called the Black Maria. And I'll head you off right here, and I have no idea why it's called the Black Maria. Just like you didn't know QC and IC. I don't know why. Black Maria is what it's called. Now, he didn't get any... There's no winners to this contest, actually, because I guess they weren't necessarily satisfied with the designs that were submitted, if there were any. This is really McGee's design. He kind of came up with this beforehand, and then he had a recent graduate, engineering graduate from the University of Oklahoma, a Gerald Hale, help him sort of tweak it and, you know, make it, you know, exactly workable and everything. They made all the interior parts, and the shell was made by a local plumber.
Hmm. Okay.
So you can kind of see that, I guess, there. So this was the winner, and now they have come up with a design. Now they have to actually, like, produce this in great numbers. So what they do... is they get in a company called the Macnick Company of Tulsa. They made timing devices used to explode nitroglycerin in oil wells.
Hmm.
Isn't that crazy? Now they're going to make a parking meter. But wow. They contracted them to build these, and they built 175 of them. And on July 16th, 1935, the first parking meter ever was installed in the United States, and it was in Oklahoma City at the corner of First Street and Robinson Avenue.
It's coming up to its birthday.
It is.
July 16th.
We're getting
right
there, July 16th. And that is Oklahoma City there with some cars parked there.
Looks like
meter.
Somebody getting a ticket.
Someone's
too.
Already getting a ticket, which cracks me up. So these 175 meters were installed on 14 blocks in Oklahoma City. And it basically proved successful, which we'll get into in a second. And the city then puts meters all over the place.
So how much did they have to pay that first day?
It was a nickel for an hour.
I think that was pretty steep back then.
I'll get to that, too. It's interesting.
Oh, okay.
So he, McGee, then basically gets a whole bunch of businessmen in the area, like over 100, to basically give him money and create the Dual Parking Meter Company. And it has offices in Oklahoma City, and these units that he was building, they were first known as the Dual, and then they later became the Parkometer. And McGee held the patents for them. And after World War II, he basically renamed the company and reorganized it a bit. It's now, after World War II, called the McGee Hale, Gerald Hale. That's where that comes from, his old buddy back there, Parkometer Company. And they made these in Oklahoma City. And the Dual was sold, like the name and all that, was sold to a company in Ohio. So they become a competitor, really. But here they are. There's a nice mannered young lady putting money in there. Now, you'll notice that that parking meter is very different from the Black Maria that won the contest. I get the sense that the Black Maria was kind of a prototype. I think the innards are pretty much the same, but they, you know, made it a little more attractive looking than that, and a little more streamlined. It's very 30s looking, really. It's like that kind of got an Art Deco-y look to it. So, yes, it was a nickel for each hour. They were placed at 20-foot intervals on the street. And the spaces were painted. You saw those lines that were painted on the street in the previous photo. And it's basically powered by, it's like a clock. You know, it's like a clock type spring in there. And it does, they do need to be wound. Someone does go around and wind these up. That's
oh, really?
How. Yep.
Okay. Because mm-hmm. I think meters
like
nowadays, well, maybe not. I haven't. Put my, but, you know, you'd put your quarter in or whatever it is.
Yes.
And then you would wind it yourself.
Yes, they're more
like a timer, sort of.
Yes, yeah.
Okay.
Yep. Now they.
But then all you did was just put a money in.
Yeah.
Put a money in.
A money, just one money.
Okay.
Unless you're staying for 2 hours and you put two monies in. Reporter. Okay. Reporter William Orrick Jr. of the California Law Review, he called these the greatest traffic invention since the stoplight. And people pretty much notice almost immediately that it helps. It helps with traffic flow, and it helps kind of ease up all the congestion. People get moving quicker. You know, people don't want to, they don't want to be in their space for 2 hours if they paid for one. You know, they might get fined, so they kind of move. Mm-hmm. You know, they get people in and out of the city faster. It gets rid of these people that were just kind of making up their own parking spaces and therefore restricting the roads and the traffic flow. It actually also reduces crime because I was reading how like they start hiring, you know, the attendants like to go around and collect the money and put the fines like that guy on the motorcycle there. And even though they're, you know, they're still law enforcement technically. So this the presence of them kind of deterred some crime. Okay. There was more people around kind of watching things. But of course, you know, there's people that don't like it, obviously. Drivers hate it for the most part. You know, they felt it was a tax on their right to own vehicles. And the argument they use a lot of times is, this is a public road. I don't have to pay to drive on it, so I shouldn't have to pay to park on it.
Mm-hmm.
Which a lot of cities get around that with this whole... the charge isn't for using the public space, but the fees are paying for the enforcement of parking, not the space. So the fee is paying this guy's salary, but it's not actually...
Kind of a
it's a Mobius strip there of, you know, reasoning. Another way they kind of get around that whole it's a public space is they limit the hours of enforcement, which you still see today, you know, parking not enforced, what, like 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. or something. That was another way they got out of that legally. So storekeepers, for the most part, really like them because it gets their customers a chance to actually park in front of their store. And in fact, Oklahoma City, when they installed these, those first 175, they only did it on one side of the street. And the businesses on the other side that didn't get them saw pretty quickly the effects and they started clamoring for them like almost right away. That's photos from 1942. That's in Seattle, actually. But this is the guy who is walking around collecting the coins out of the thing, and I've seen that a lot of pictures like that. They have their little carts and they go around and collect them. Here's a weird fun trivia fact for you, Dan. So other companies start springing up too. You know, it's not just McGee Hale. You know, they sell the dual part, so that's another company. There's another one called Mark Time. And then there's Duncan Miller, and that's what this is. This is a Miller parking meter. And this is from the late 30s. I only bring this up because this story just cracks me up. So the Duncan there is from a man named Donald Duncan, and he bought the Miller meter business and made it Duncan Miller. Would you like to know how he made his, you know, gajillion dollars?
Go ahead.
He made yo-yos.
Dunkin' yo-yos.
Yeah! So that was, this has nothing to do with cars, but it was interesting. So he apparently was on a trip in California in 1928, and he saw a man, Pedro Flores, and who was a Filipino immigrant. He was, you know, playing with a yo-yo. And he was just really, he was just so intrigued by that. But already Flores was also a smart businessman. He had already started making these and selling them. He trademarked the yo-yo name, this Flores, smart man. And he was hiring other Filipinos to go around and demonstrate like all the tricks you can do, because he thought it wouldn't sell if people didn't know what you could do with it.
Right.
And I didn't know yo-yos. I was reading then about yo-yos, and that was like a Filipino art form. That was it was really interesting. So, but anyway, Duncan was just so intrigued by this guy and what he was doing, and he bought the rights from Flores, and by 1932, you know, basically bought the yo-yo name and stuff. And he was similar, thinking, you know, you had to tell people what you could do. So he put out these, like, trick books and stuff. So, yeah, Duncan Yo-Yos. He was in the car meter business, meter business, too.
So what came first, the yo-yo or the
parking meter?
Parking meter.
Ooh, the yo-yo.
Yeah, okay, because he made his money there, and then got it.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
Weird.
Because they're so unrelated.
They're so unrelated, but it was too funny.
Yeah.
Then, of course, there's also the meter maid startup in the 1950s, and that's extremely unpopular, you know, to have these ladies scribbling down your information, giving you tickets. But then I found this was funny, too. In 1965... there's a tourist destination in Australia called Surfer's Paradise. They decided, they still do this, I found out, but they decided to put their meter maids in beach wear so that they didn't look like stuck-up old ladies giving you tickets. And I just thought that was hilarious. They still do this, apparently. And then, of course, there's the people that find ways to put advertising on these parking meters. Ad is the company I found, and they're really difficult to search for because the name is so generic, and I get a lot of weird stuff that has nothing to do with it. But that was one way they did it, putting this little like mini billboard on top. That's really hard to see. But on the post there's like a three-sided placard that goes around the post.
Beneath the meter itself.
Yep, and that was a way to get... more revenue, because cities love these things, because, you know, not only do they get the nickels, they get the revenue from all the fines that are put out. By the 1940s, there's over 140,000 parking meters across the United States, and by 1944, that's generating $10 million worth of revenue a year. So now they put ads on it, and they can figure out more ways. They're very mechanical. Like we said, they're mechanical. You know, they would take them back in the shop and repair them. I think that's actually a Wichita repairman working, a city worker doing that. In the 1980s is when they start to shift from the mechanical to a battery-operated system. And in New York City, at least, they replaced their last mechanical meter in 2006. And you said about the price and how that was kind of steep. Actually, believe it or not, if you adjust for inflation, I was reading, the cost of parking really hasn't changed much in 90 years. And Parkometer is still around. It's now just POM. It still makes meters. Now they have, of course, the digital screens. And you can pay with a credit card. So that company's still around and still making things. And now we talked about our colorful friend, McGee.
Oh, yeah.
Who had a colorful past and then made something as mundane as a parking meter, which is interesting. But he wasn't the first to file a patent for a parking meter. That was actually Roger Babson. And he did that on August 30th, 1928. So his meters were electrically powered. And what he wanted to do was to hook it up to the battery of the car being parked. It's needlessly complicated. I was looking at the patent. The title of the patent, it's called a check-controlled apparatus for measurement and payment of intangible values.
Right there.
Done. Done. That's it. Don't need it. So that is a little history on the parking meter.
Okay.
I had no idea I would be talking about yo-yos, though, and as part of
yo-yos.
That. And a manslaughter charge.
Yeah. Yeah.
I love it. He's acquitted and he goes and just works another paper, like, okay. And works on this pet project of his that made him a lot of money. So I think we have a few minutes for
We have a few
quiz,
minutes.
Right?
So if you could throw the first picture on there for car quiz.
And the phone number here to the studio to call in is 610-378-0426. It's up there on your screen too.
You know, you mentioned the shell of those first meters were made by a local plumber. And it reminded me, because they could do casting and stuff, of our dial, which was a local plumber, and we think some of the casting in the car was done by him.
I forgot about that.
That's why I'm here.
Look at the, see? You said we didn't have Pennsylvania. We brought our dial and drag it into all this mess tonight. So.
We dragged our dial in. And
I think I heard the phone ring, so we might have a... Yep. Good evening.
Hello, Dan. How you doing?
Hello.
Yeah. Dan.
Yeah. Hi.
Okay. Does that happen to be a Rambler American or not?
It could be. Yes, it is. It is. Give me a year, though. I'm not going to let you off that easy.
Maybe about a 62 or something like that. I'm not really familiar with
it. I think starting in 61, they were kind of pretty square, which is the ones I like. So this is prior to that. This is a 1960.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and... I understand the a lot of the stuff from that car goes back to the early 50s. They kept using the thing. You know, the body was updated and stuff, and I don't know, there's some other things going on. But, yeah, that's that car.
I had a 62, a Rambler Classic. That was one of those. Some of them were good and some of them weren't. It had the aluminum engine in, and that was...
Really? Okay.
Oh.
It had an aluminum engine in, but here, like I said, some of the engines were good and some are bad. It must have got too hot. And what happened, it got hairline cracks in the cylinder walls, in the fifth and sixth cylinder, and the water would go in with the oil in the engine.
Right.
The temperature gauge, you know, went up through the sky, and that, you know, that was it. But although I know a couple people that had, you know, Ramblers with aluminum engines, and they never had no problems with them.
What type of, how many cylinders did that engine have?
Six-cylinder.
Six-cylinder, okay.
Six-cylinder automatic. You know, it was a nice car to drive and everything, but, you know, like I said, I bought it when it was used already, and then I bought it off a second-hand dealer, and he knew they must have doctored it up, and then, you know, he sold it to me, and then, you know, I got caught holding the bag with it. I had a cast iron engine put in, and then it was all right. But you always have an interesting show, you know, you and Kendra, and
thank you.
Always enjoy watching it.
Thank you.
Take care. Have a good rest of the night.
Okay, yep.
Thank you. You too.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Well, we're almost done here before we can throw another car up. But, you know, I like those Ramblers, one, because they're different. You do not see them too often.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes you see a station wagon like that. They actually made a little panel truck based on them.
Really?
I've seen photographs of it. I think it was like prototypes. But there is one or two of them out there still.
Ooh.
And it would just be a neat little kind of clunky car or vehicle.
You know, I like the panel trucks and the... That would be cool to see. You never saw one in person, though?
No. So.
Okay, so if our viewers have a panel truck, a Rambler panel truck, or a gas Alec, or...
You say that pretty good, yeah.
I don't know if it's right.
Yeah. Or a Wizzo bang.
Or a Wizzo
parking meter.
That's right.
We need a parking meter in a museum.
We do have a parking meter.
We do. I didn't know that.
And you know what? I forgot to look before I left who made it. So, geez, I have a lot of homework. I got to do that, and I got to write for some circulars.
Okay. Busy.
I better.
Anyway, so there's that. I think that's her. That's McCungie, I think.
I was going to guess McCungie.
Seeing the building in the background, or pavilion. I can't really tell.
No, that's a building. Are those the bathrooms?
I don't know. Restrooms. At McCungie? Restrooms.
Sorry.
They don't have bathrooms there.
Touche.
Okay.
I think it is McCungie. You would think we'd recognize that. We were just there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We weren't looking at the restrooms.
No, we weren't.
Looking at all the cars. Trucks. All the trucks.
Trucks, yeah.
Cool. He didn't even need a hint. He knew that.
He
didn't need your hints there. That
no,
was good.
No, he didn't. And what kind of hints do I have? Optional Flasho Drive automatic transmission. It was $178.
Flasho Drive.
I love some of the names that they have for this stuff.
I agree.
And it's why I always look for them when I write these notes for you.
I like those names, and I like how they write, like, ad copy. Like that one you had tonight, you know, not a freak.
Oh, like, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I didn't think it was. I just like how they talk. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right.
He just told us we have 1 minute.
He did. I think they want us to leave, so I guess we better
leave.
He
wants to go home. I don't want to because it's nice and cool in here.
I know. It's hot out there. It's nice
okay,
in here.
So as you're thinking in the last sentence to say, I'm going to re-invite everybody to the museum. We're open.
Yes.
You know, you don't have to wear a mask if you have the mm-hmm. shots and all mm-hmm. that stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I might be there. I could show you around.
He might be.
Or whatever, yeah. And, you know, there was somebody, I was walking around the truck show in McCungie, and I walked past this guy, and he just grabbed my arm. I turned around, who are you? And it was one of our viewers. So if you're watching, hi, it was good to meet you. Real brief
Thank
there.
Thank you. Yes.
And, yeah, it was a great show.
Yeah, so. we like meeting you guys in person.
Okay.
So
that's it.
That's right.
Sorry, now you can
come
close.
Visit us and meet us in person. Yeah. And look at the Dial and the Dragon, which relate to things we talked
Correct.
About tonight.
Yeah.
So there you go. Yeah. Thank you all for joining us here in July. We will see you in August. And hopefully before we're back here, we see you at the museum or at our electric vehicle show on July 18th. And until then, everyone stay safe and cool. And we'll see you next time. Mm-hmm.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.